Hi, Triumph fans, it's Nancy, and I'm very excited to introduce to you on the screen above me, this is world famous record producer, Mike Clink. Hi, Mike.
Hello, good to see you.
Thank you for joining us today. You're a busy guy. So I was hoping you could do me a favor. I know who you are. Most people know who you are, but...
For those two or three people that don't, sure. No, there's probably well more than that. But anyway, Mike Clink, I'm a record producer, probably best known for all the work that I've done with rock and roll bands. I started out as an engineer at the record plant in Los Angeles and set goals for myself. And one of those goals was to produce records. And one of the first bands that I produced was Triumph up in at the Metalwork Studio up in Mississauga. Some of the other records that I've worked on, you know, I've done the Sport of Kings record for Triumph. I've done all the records for Guns N' Roses, except for Chinese Democracy. I've worked with Metallica, Megadeth, Motley Crue, a lot of hard rock.
Yeah, your list is extraordinary. I think we could spend 2 hours just going through the albums that you've either mixed, engineered, or... It's incredible.
Yeah, but it's interesting because people look at me and they go, well, wait a second, you don't have tattoos, you're not, you know, swigging back Jack Daniels and smoking cigarettes. But, you know, I was always the grounding force with all those bands.
Right.
And so I was able to get the work done while there was chaos swirling around me.
Well, someone has to be the logic in the chaos. I guess that was you. Just off the record here, I have to say, a big fan of Rust in Peace. I mean, that is pure gold from start to finish. Beautiful album. Yeah, all your work's great, but that one's on, you know, replay on my iPod a lot. Okay, yeah, well, Mike, I'm just going to jump into this. We know that you, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, being completely independent on the producing of Sport of Kings. Was that your first solo producing project?
Well, it was the first project I actually got free and clear credit for, even though I had produced and co-produced a lot of records previously, mm-hmm. but I hadn't received the credit that I deserved. It was definitely, listen, I owe a lot to the guys in the band and the people at MCA Records, but mostly to, you know, Rick and Gil and Mike, that they had the faith that I would be able to pull this off, because I wasn't the original producer. I was a co-producer on the project, and things didn't work out with the original producer, and I stepped in to fill the role, and I think we came out with a great record, something that everybody was proud of. And so, you know, it was their faith in me that gave me the opportunity to step to the other side and get that credit.
And as a Triumph fan, I think we're all very grateful. We know where that record was heading before you stepped in to sort of take the reins and bring it to where it needed to be. So thank you. And by the way, you're going to make a brief appearance in the Triumph movie when they talk about that movie, about that album.
Yes. I've seen the rough cut. So it's a brief moment in time in that movie. I thought that they would kind of focus more about me, more about me, but apparently they thought Triumph was more important than myself.
Well, yeah, but there's your 5 minutes of fame from a screen point of view in front of the camera.
Yes.
Okay, well, Mike, I'll just jump into it. The first question I have for you is, how and when did the concept for creating a Triumph tribute album begin? And to expand on that, was it your idea? Was it collaborative? Did the band come to you?
Well, I tell you, I was working up in Huntsville with an artist named Les Stroud, and he's probably better known as Survivor Man. He's a kind of a Canadian icon. And, you know, I had put a studio in his house, and we do a lot of records up there in Huntsville. And the recording was done. We were headed back, and I believe it was in April. And this was probably 3 years ago now. Unbelievably, in the middle of April, we got snowed in. it was, we were driving back. The trip took 5 hours to get back. It was a mess. And all the flights had been canceled. So I got a hotel and I called Gil and I said, hey, Gil, you know, I'm not expecting you to do anything. I just wanted to say hello. And he said, Mike, I'll be there in 10 minutes. And so he came through a snowstorm. And I mean, it was a blizzard. He came and picked me up and we went out to dinner and it was just fantastic. We went to this restaurant and had a great meal. And we started talking about some of the things that were going on with Triumph. Now, I've been in touch with the guys. It wasn't just like a call out of the blue, you know, that I made, you know, at least a couple times a year and definitely once a year, you know, I would reach out to the guys and say hello. And we just sat there and Gil was telling me about the things that were going on with Triumph. And one of them was the documentary. And they hadn't even started the documentary. They were kind of putting it together, a couple of the ideas, who was going to do it, who was going to help fund it, this and that. And he said, we should do a record a lot to go with the release of the film, the documentary. And so that was the genesis of it. That was the seed that started the whole thing. So after I got back to LA, you know, there were emails back and forth between Gil and Mike, and we started talking about this. And Mike came to Los Angeles on a trip, and we went out and talked about the record and how it was going to be put together. And I had done a couple records. I had done a record with a band called Camp Freddy, which had a core band. You know, it was Matt Sorum on drums, Dave Navarro on guitar, Billy Morrison from The Cult on guitar, Donovan Leitch on vocals, Chris Chaney from Jane's Addiction on bass. And we would get guest stars and record songs, cover songs, and release them. We got a couple songs put in some soundtracks. So that was my initial thought of how we might approach this, that we would have a core band and then have maybe a couple guest artists. And we decided through the course of how this morphed, we decided to, you know, forgo that idea and then just get a whole plethora of artists. And I think now we're getting up to 30 or 40 different artists, and it just makes it a little bit more interesting, you know, to have all these different people play on the record and do that. And then we didn't have a label at the moment, but, you know, Roundhill came on board and we're making this record for Roundhill, and we're very happy and very excited about it. So that's the genesis of the record, and we're right now right in the middle of it.
It sounds like it started long before the documentary started. So this conversation could be what, 3, 4, 5 years old?
It's at least 3 years old. And it was just, you know, we didn't start recording. It was just the idea of, sure, how would we do it if it happened? You know, what would it look like? And those kind of things.
Well, that's amazing. So I guess I'm going to jump to the next question. I'm not going to do them in order. I sent you a list, but now I've decided to switch up my order.
Do them however you want to do them.
Well,
I can move on a dime.
I know you work under pressure. You can work with the best of the rock stars. I'm sure you can manage a little on me. Recording a majority of this album during COVID lockdown, has this obviously made this a unique recording experience compared to any others that you've done? Has it made it easier, harder? It's COVID. How has that affected you guys?
God, it's been, you know, it's made it more difficult just because, God, there's so many. I mean, that's a question that could go on for an hour. But I'll try to break it down. What has made it difficult is with the ebb and flow of the virus and the different lockdowns we've had, that's created the difficult issues for us. So it's been difficult to get, you know, some of the artists that I want, not everybody lives in LA. So to ask someone to get on board an airplane and fly for 5 hours cross country during COVID was something that we weren't gonna do.
Right.
And that made it difficult to get everybody in the studio. However, every song that we've recorded, I actually waited for a lull to be able to get into the studio because for a while here in LA, we were locked down and you weren't able to record anything. I mean, right. I'll back up and tell you that I was in the middle of a project. I had been working in New Zealand, brought the band over here to Los Angeles. And we were 2 or 3 weeks, we had already cut the tracks here. We were 2 or 3 weeks into the overdubs and LA just shut down. I mean, you couldn't go anywhere and there was nothing on the shelves. And it was a terrible experience for the band. It was a band called Capitol Theater. And they just said, this is not gonna work. And I said it wasn't gonna work. It's just, you know, they couldn't buy basic supplies. I mean, you couldn't, I don't know what it was like up in Toronto, but it was pretty bad here. So they booked a flight out a couple of days later and left. And I finished the record through Zoom. And it's not a great experience because I was on Zoom for, 5, 6, 7 hours a day.
Wow.
And I make decisions when I'm recording. I make decisions in a second, in a couple seconds. I know right away if it's not feeling good. So I stop, I go back, you know, I explain what I want to do. But when you do it via Zoom, you're as good as the talent on the other end of the at the other end of the Zoom call.
Yeah.
And there were many times that I was just going, this is not right. Stop, stop, stop. And you know, everybody in the studio is just looking around and the vocalist is singing out of tune or the guitar player is not playing the right part. And I'm just going, it just makes it, that part of it made it very difficult for that particular record. I did not have as much of that with the Triumph record. I kind of, there were a couple of artists that just absolutely refused to get into the studio with me. And that was maybe only two of the artists. On the other hand, there were several of the artists who wouldn't come until they knew it was safe to come.
Sure.
And,
yeah.
You know, we had had the vaccines and the studios were adhering to all the protocol. And, you know, that was difficult to get people to come in until that happened, but we did and we got it done. And I would say that 85 to 90% of this record has been done with me in person with the members of the band. And, but that's not to say that COVID did not have an impact, and especially with the time factor. That's why it's taken so long, because we've had to wait until number one, the studios were open, and number two, to where there was a level of comfort for people to feel like they can be in a room together. Sure. So,
well, yeah, I mean, COVID's really, you know, put the brakes on life. I mean, it's put the brakes on the documentary coming out. I mean, that has been, you know, yeah, it's COVID, you know. I was just interested because, you know, the sort of organic energy that I think you and any act in a recording studio together, like it's a symbiotic relationship. So I was curious if you were in separate entities and, you know, sound bites and things were being downloaded. I mean, magic.
See, that's a good point. And that's why I didn't want to do it, because there's an energy that happens when everybody gets in a room and plays off of each other. And I can't tell you how excited the guys were and the gals, because we've had, Nita Strauss on the record, to be able, how excited they were to be able to get into a room and actually feed off of me, feed off of each other. And it was such a welcome situation that it was great. And we would not have gotten some of those performances had we not been able to be in that room together. And I just don't like doing it any other way, especially for cutting tracks where you get 4 or 5 guys together in a room and just watch the magic happen. Yeah. It's phenomenal.
Well, I'm excited. Now, I know you just dropped a name. I'm gonna come back to that, but I wanted to know, can Triumph fans expect a really good cross-section of Triumph's catalog of music from this? Like how did you go about choosing the songs that would be, or still choosing, because you said we're halfway, How did you just sort of have this master list of artists, like guitarists and drummers, and you thought this vocal and this person would match?
Well, that's curious. Two questions. You just asked me two questions.
I know. So trying to sneak in one more question for you.
So I'll answer the first one as far as, you know, can they expect a wide range of Triumph songs? Because this is on a record label, we really focused in on some of the more well-known songs of Triumph. And, you know, it's always great when you can pull out those, you know, songs that people are not familiar with and make them familiar with it. But it was important on this record for the band and myself, and also the record label to do songs that everybody knows.
Yeah.
And we've gotten great performances from them. I've rearranged all the songs. I mean, there's not one song. Like, if you're listening to the songs, they don't go where you think they're going to go.
Nice.
You know, there was, like,
Gil had said this album is going to take us in places that are, it's just going to surprise us all.
Yeah, I mean, it's not going to be a 180 degree turn. However, if you're waiting for a particular thing to happen, it may or may not happen. And I think you might have heard the one song has been released. It was released for the box set for Allied Forces. And that was Allied Forces is a song that we did. And I would imagine that most people who even bought that box set never even heard it, because they didn't want to open the package and play the song. And it was only available at this point on record. It's a little, I think it's a 7-inch. So
yeah.
Most people haven't even heard that. But if you listen to that song out of the box set, you'll know that it's not
Triumph.
That you've heard. Have you heard it? I can't remember.
Oh yeah. In fact, I heard it, and I was working with Andy Kern on the box set for, you know, they would call me once in a while for a couple questions. And when I heard it, I called him immediately. I said, "That's not Triumph." And he's like, "Oh, you got a good ear." So I never let the cat out of the bag. I wanted, you know, fans to find out organically, because it's heavy. It's definitely Triumph, but it's like a bunch of raging horses are flying through it. It's a really good mix that Phil did. It was really, well, you did a good job.
Yeah. It's pretty powerful.
Yeah, it's got some meat on its bones, that one.
Yeah, it's sure. I'm very happy with that. Phil X and Brian Tishy and Daniel Spree just really, they brought it. They it sounds incredible.
Well, I mean, that's just a taste of what's coming. Triumph fans have a lot of excitement coming for this album.
Oh yeah. I mean, that's the tip of the iceberg.
It's just the tip. Well, okay. So my next question, so we're going to get, basically, we're not going to do a lot of deep B cuts on the tribute album, but there might be some surprises. Project,
you know, maybe down the line. I mean, I was on a call with Gil and Mike and Adam from the label the other day. And you know, we were kind of talking, you know, a little bit about, you know, deep cuts and different things for the record. And I think that the consensus was, let's just keep focused on doing what we started to do and get that done. And maybe in, who knows what time frame, right, you know, we'll do something different.
There's always a chance to do a deep cut tribute album down the road.
Yeah, absolutely. And maybe do it differently than we've done this one, you know, so there's a lot of possibilities, but I think that for the moment, our focus is on this record, and it's going to be great. I mean, Triumph fans, if you're a Triumph fan, you're going to love it.
All right.
I could use other ways to explain it, but that's the most.
Coming from you. Yeah, we can't wait. Okay. Yeah. So I guess my next question will be, did you have particular art? Oh, this was, I guess, part two of that question I just asked you. Right. Did you have particular artists in mind for each song on the album? And how was it determined which artists would collaborate with other artists? How did that come together?
Well, it's, you know, it's your questions are always twofold. I mean, my answer, you ask the question, but my answers are always twofold. So number one, did I have an idea of who I wanted to use for the record? Yes, absolutely. I had a list of people that I wanted to get on the record. Okay. Gil and Mike had a list of people that they wanted to get on the record. So, you know, we went out for those asks, and the key to this was getting people to pair with their strengths on the songs from Triumph, you know, because not everyone is, you know, there's a shuffle and then there's, you know, kind of a pop rock hit. And then, you know, some of the melodic stuff, and then there's some of the rockers. So it's figuring out who's right for each song. And I knew most of the musicians, not all of them. And that was great because I met people that I had never worked with previously. And that was a lot of fun. But, you know, they have to have a comfort level. I mean, it wasn't just my decision or the band's decision. It was also the musician's decision on, like, well, can I really do justice to the song? And, you know, a lot of people had to say, you know what, I love the song, but I don't feel like I can deliver. And I never want to put someone in to a situation where they will fail. So, sure. So, you know, we were very careful about, you know, picking the right songs. However, we did get a couple people out of their comfort zone, which was great, you know, and that's what I always like to do, is get them out of their comfort zone, get them to do things that they don't think that they can do. But it was a little bit more difficult because the arrangement process I did on my own, and Phil X helped a lot. And, you know, we would rearrange the songs. So when we got in there, they were done, and they had to kind of go along with it. But everyone was really happy. And they had their own ideas as well. I mean, don't get me wrong. When Kenny Aronoff is playing, he goes, that Phil is just not going to work. Let me do it again. Let me try something different. And I mean, all these guys are a game players.
Sure. I'll
let that thing ring out.
That's okay. We said we were just going to plow through this because time is precious to get you on a
phone call. I have actually until 1 o'clock. Who has a landline these days?
Yeah, I thought it could have been a cell phone that sounds like landline. No,
it's a landline. I have to have a landline because of the alarm on the house. You know, they have to have a line that connects up to the station.
Keeping it old school, Mike. You're keeping it old school.
Yeah. Well, you have to. It's crazy. Yeah.
All right. Well, I know you've dropped a couple names now, so I'm going to come back to that. I'm super interested though. Like, again, I'm just talking about Dave Mustaine and Megadeth. But he was quoted to say that he's drawn to you as a producer and engineer because you come into a project with the end in mind. So you've already sort of have a vision of what you want it to be like. Was that the same here, or did that happen easily because you had great talent?
No, I knew what the end result would be. And I knew what the final project, the final product was going to be like. I knew what it was going to be like. Some of the songs have taken, you know, a little bit of a twist and a turn. However, I'm a little stuck for some reason. I had a vision, and I know what needs to be done in order to get it to the point where the Triumph fans are going to hear it and go, oh yes, yeah, I love that. There's nothing, there's no filler on this record. It's all great stuff. And how to accomplish that? I mean, I always have a plan A and a plan B. So if plan A doesn't work, we're going to plan B. And sometimes we got to go to plan C as well.
Yeah, I guess the only predictable thing is life can be unpredictable.
Yes.
And with the different styles that your artists have come into the studio with, I mean, Nita Strauss, you mentioned, I mean, she's got her own guitar style. Mind you, she's she's quite a diverse player, big fan. So I'm actually super excited that she's going to be on the album. But do you allow them, I shouldn't say allow, but do you give them stylistic freedom to sort of put their own little polishing pieces so that if someone was listening, they might be like, oh my God, I think that's Nita Strauss, if they didn't know they were listening to Nita, or, oh my gosh, I know that's Sebastian Bach because of a, you know, certain way he performs. Did you allow that to happen, or did you have to curb that a bit?
Yeah, it's easier with the vocalist, but like in the case of Nita Strauss, I don't think that anyone would be able to pick her out of the particular song that she played on, because she's not playing in the usual style that she plays.
Okay.
So, and that was an artist that I took out of her comfort zone. And, you know, she was like, wow, I've never played anything like this before. And it was fun. It was a challenge for her. She excelled at the task and did a great job. So sometimes, as I was saying previously, that people are put into a situation where they've got to do something different. And that's always fun. I mean, I just enjoy seeing it, like in the case of Nita, you know, when she would nail a part and, you know, just smile, I'd go, wow, you know, this is great. You know, you're doing it.
Awesome. I hope you got some video footage in the studio.
We do have
footage. We'll have to talk almost
everyone.
Nice. That's amazing.
Yeah. I don't know.
I'm excited.
We'll see how good it is, but I mean,
we'll pick anything. I mean, we all love the end project, but for me, and I'm sure a lot of other people, it's the little juicy tidbits along the way that just add the layers of excitement. I mean, right now, people are learning names that are on the album. They don't know. I'm actually going to ask you if you could drop a few more names without getting yourself in trouble, without giving too much away.
Boy, who could I drop? You know, obviously Phil X and Daniel Spree and Brian Tichy. Mm-hmm. From who played on Allied Forces, and I'm not going to tell you what every song.
Yeah, I like the mystery.
Only because that one is a known entity. But we had Nita Strauss on the record. We've had Sebastian on the record. We've had a Canadian Tyler Connolly play on the record, sing on the record. Okay. Mickey Thomas has sung on the record. We've had Tony Franklin play bass on the record. Chris Cheney, Todd Kearns. Wow. So
great lineup. Oh my gosh.
Yeah, and we've had Tommy Aldridge playing drums, Josh Fries playing drums. I mean, people who know these names will be very happy to hear them. So
yeah, they will. So I know,
but there's some others. I just don't want to give. I don't want, as we said, we want it to be almost like an Easter egg where you uncover and discover.
Sure. It's definitely going to be one of those records where you pull out the sleeve and you are looking at every credit and dropping the needle on the record over and over just to pull out those sounds and figure out who's playing what. It's exciting.
Absolutely. Yeah.
I know the last time you and I had our first official Zoom meeting, we were on a meeting and the topic of the album title came up. I spoke to Gil just a couple of days ago. He said that there's still no title, at least not one that he was going to share with me, but I think he was forthwright that there's no title. And I think you and I got shot down on our title suggestions.
Yeah, I don't think there is a title. I mean, however, I think that my title was a home run.
Yep.
And you know, I'm not always right, but I'm never.
Well, maybe we should keep it a secret in case it gets used.
Yeah, I'm not going to say what it is.
I'm not going to say it. It was good. It's still good.
I think it's great. Because it explains exactly what we're doing in one word.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I guess only time will tell.
Yes.
All right. Well, last question. Any idea when Triumph fans might be able to expect this record?
You know what? We were talking about that the other day, and I think that the plan is the end of the first quarter or beginning of the second quarter.
Sounds good.
Yeah.
I mean, until it's done right, you know, I think you and I talked, and there was you were waiting on a phone call from a particular artist for vocals.
And still waiting.
You wouldn't say who it was because you don't want to jinx it. So I know that it's still a process in the making, but so maybe the second quarter, maybe.
Yeah.
Sometime next year.
Yeah, it's not going to be this year.
No, yeah.
Nothing under the tree this year.
All right. But, you know, Triumph fans have, you know what, Triumph has had like this resurgence and sort of a renaissance in the last few years, which I'm super happy to be able to witness. And I'm so glad that this is happening and that you're behind the wheel on this. Triumph fans and music fans are in for a real treat.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. And I'm going to hold you to it. I'm going to hold myself to it.
Well, we're going to connect again because we're going to talk about the B-side tribute album. Maybe we can, we're going to re-collaborate down the road on Triumph's B-side.
Yes, let's
do it. All right, Mike. Well, thanks for joining us today. I hope it's nice and sunny and warm in California. I know up here in Canada, it is not sunny and warm. It's snowy and it definitely looks like a Christmas postcard here. But
yeah.
Stay warm, stay safe, and Triumph fans love you. And thanks for hanging out with me today. And
thanks for having me. I love it.
All right. Until next time. Bye, Mike.
Until next time. All right. Bye-bye, guys. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.